So nothing to disclose. And let's just jump into it. So do we need to define pain? So I think we all have a very intuitive sense of what pain is. We all experience it. Ultimately, we know that if we don't treat pain, there's a lot of consequences to it. And so you can see some of the unresolved consequences, issues with sleep, walking, intimacy, concentration, working, etc. And when we get into the healthcare system, especially if you're elderly, that also impacts other things. You can have doctors who write more medications just because of pain, malnutrition, prolonged hospitalizations, and other issues that we see. As far as the technical definition, it's described as an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience associated with actual or potential tissue damage, or described in terms of such damage. But in reality, it really is a subjective experience. So we all have an intuitive sense of what pain is, and if I look at somebody, it's very hard for me to say, yes, you have 3 out of 10 pain, or you have 5 out of 10 pain. It really is impossible to say. And so, for example, has anyone ever been angry? Not in this room, right? What happens if you get acutely angry? You get, upset. So what happens with your body, though? Sure, cortisol, so your heart rate may go up. You may get flushed. You may start sweating a little bit as well, too. Can you stay angry and still keep the heart rate up, keep, staying flushed, everything else? People can stay mad, for very long periods of time, but yet outside, you actually look exactly the same. And that's the same, unfortunately, or fortunately, with pain, where, when somebody says, I have pain and it's 10 out of 10, and then they're joking and they're laughing, it's really hard to say, is this person truly having a 10 out of 10 pain? They're laughing, they must be faking. It's actually not the case necessarily. You physiologically go back to normal, even though you have potentially a lot of pain. So my background is I'm also a hospice and palliative medicine physician, board certified. One of the founders of the hospice movement, Dame Cicely Saunders, actually coined a concept called total pain. And so it's not just the physical pain that people experience, but it really is a multidimensional construct. So if you have physical pain, that's one aspect, but then it's also taking a toll on people psychologically, spiritually, as well as socially. And you think about, gastric cancer, you think about any other type of cancer. And so if it's a young woman or a young man, they have young children in the home, say they're the sole breadwinner in the house, right? So now it's, I have, this massive thing that just happened to me. I wasn't planning for this. And so think about the psychological toll. If they're the ones who are caring for their family and they're the ones who are providing the finances, then it's what's going to happen with my family, who's going to take care of my children and other things. And all of those actually impact that perception of pain. So we really need to look at all of those things, not just a single one. In terms of how we think about pain, and this is a little bit medical, but there's a couple main breakdowns that we have. So one is what we call nociceptive pain or neuropathic pain. And so nociceptive pain is oftentimes broken out into what we call somatic or visceral. Oftentimes when we think about the stomach, in terms of stomach cancer, it's oftentimes a visceral piece. And so this is often sometimes crampy, squeezing pain is poorly localized, and it can go in various places. It can sometimes radiate to, if you think about, say, the gallbladder, for example, that might go to the shoulder or go to the back. And so you have gastric cancer that can move in different places. It's also very close to a lot of the nerves as well. So when you think about neuropathic pain, and so it's not just nociceptive pain, but there's a component of nerve pain that's associated with it as well that we need to address. So in terms of the percentages, about 74 to 90% of people, most people with gastric cancer actually do have pain. Sometimes the pain manifests itself in different ways. And so we heard in the nutrition lecture earlier, sometimes you have that dyspepsia or burning sensation. Other people will have burning pain in the epigastrium. And so in kind of this upper area, just the top of the abdomen is where other people have pain. But when we think about pain, it's not necessarily, and we'll get into some of the myths here in a second, but we really want to think about the functional activity and the functional level of people. And so what are you able to do even with that pain or without it? And so this is just a couple lists of what we call the instrumental activities of daily living, both basic and instrumental. And so even just things as far as bathing, dressing, being able to feed yourself, etc., are all important things that we need to be able to see, can people actually do? There's sometimes different things that doctors will use to assess pain. So you have sometimes, this is actually more used in kids, but the faces scale. And so sometimes people think you look at the faces and you look at the kids, what's their level of pain? It's actually, it's more you ask the kids and say, you know, what is your level of pain? Which one do you feel like ultimately? I know some people love the number scale and they can rate their pain really well. Other people say, doc, if you ask me one more time what my number of pain is, I'm going to give you some pain. You know, so it really depends on who the person is ultimately. As far as some nuances as well, we also have to think about some cultural and gender differences as well too when we think about pain. And so with cultural differences, sometimes you have actually generally stoic and emotive cultures. And so the stoic cultures are oftentimes the Northern European and Asian backgrounds. And so they'll often say, you know, they're less expressive of pain. And so they'll say, you know, just kind of grin and bear it. Whereas some of the more emotive cultures, Hispanic, Middle Eastern, Mediterranean backgrounds, they're more oftentimes to sort of verbalize their expressions of pain. And they often prefer to have people around and expect others to react to their pain as to validate their discomfort. And so oftentimes I say, you know, really just think about how people treat their kids, right? So what happens if your two-year-old falls and hurts themselves? So in some ways, it's almost, some people are like, oh my gosh, you poor baby, let me go ahead and hold you and pick you up and coddle you. And other people are like, come on, kid, like, you know, shrug it off. It's fine. Stop crying. When you're done crying, I'll go ahead and hold you and take care of you, you know. So, but I think it really is important to think about who is the individual, right? So these are kind of just generalized stereotypes for cultures, but it really is who is the person in front of you and how do they actually experience pain. Another thing that's important to also consider, there was a lecture that I actually had attended looking at minority aspects within pain as well. And so when you think about some of the intricacies there, sometimes it's even that they sometimes will have less access to pain management, are less likely to have pain recorded, they receive less pain medications. So it's just something that we have to be mindful of culturally and try and see how we can address it. One of the really telling things was they actually had a map, just like a Google map, of geographic populations. And so you have some cultural communities. And literally in some minority communities, there's actually less prevalence of pharmacies that carried opioids. And so it's one of those things where even just physical proximity to pain medications was less in these cases. In terms of gender differences, scientifically, when they've studied this in kind of, you know, labs or other things, it's been women have higher prevalence for most chronic pain conditions varying by life cycle and stage. Women also have a lower pain threshold and less tolerance for painful stimuli. And from a medical community, we've actually handled pain complaints less adequately. And so just something to be mindful of as we think about pain and how do we actually address that. And we have to be more responsive in these situations. So as far as the myths that we have out there. So myth one, I would say the goal of pain management is to make patients pain-free, get to zero, right? I don't want any pain whatsoever. So I would say that that is a myth, right? If we give people enough medications or other things to get their pain to zero, that may be way too much. And so really the goal of our therapy is to manage pain to a level which allows engagement activities, you know, which achieve an acceptable quality of life. So if it's, you know, I have a 3 out of 10 pain, it's always there, but I'm able to do everything I need to do. I'm able to take care of myself. I'm able to go out, enjoy, you know, time with my family, do other things. We would actually say that that's a good thing. If we give you more, you may actually have additional side effects from it that are not as ideal. A second myth I would say is the medical system only provides narcotics for pain control. That's our only option. Is how many people have experienced only opioids being given to patients? Okay, well, hopefully there definitely are other options. So I would say there's definitely non-medication options out there. So we think about cognitive techniques. So you have things like just even simple distraction, problem-solving therapy, socialization. There's behavioral techniques as well, too. So oftentimes these are through social work, through psychology, other team members who are there. There's also things like yoga, tai chi, massage, acupuncture, acupressure, hypnosis. We'll get into a couple of these things here. But non-medications options are out there and can help with pain overall as part of the strategy. So as far as acupuncture, available to some extent in certain places, but they have actually started to study this in the post-operative setting. And so they've actually seen that when you have acupuncture and it's done for postoperative pain, you actually can reduce the amount of opioids, sometimes by, you know, 20% over the first 8 hours, which is oftentimes, you know, the most painful post-surgically, and then in decreasing amounts. And it also can help with acute non-surgical pain as well, too. And so that's something to just be mindful of. It doesn't work for everyone. And so, you know, if you are doing acupuncture, I usually tell people try it for about like 7 to 10 times. And so you should at least give it a fair shake. But if it doesn't work, then, you know, don't waste your money. But if it does, then it becomes an opportunity. Massage is another one. And so, again, this is, you know, having various degrees of availability. But this also can help with postoperative pain, can help in general with cancer pain too. And so this has also been found to be beneficial. Sometimes if it's a spouse who's there, I'll say, you know, doctor's prescribing the spouse to massage patient X number of times. So there's also mind-directed therapies. So music, hypnosis, virtual reality. There's a lot of other things that are out there as well. And these also, again, not to, you know, belabor this, but all these things essentially say in the post-operative setting and in other places, these have been helpful. One of the fun things that I was reading, just kind of intuitive, is if somebody's wearing virtual reality glasses and you're walking around, one of the potential side effects is that you can run into objects in the real world. So, and then biofeedback therapies are also there. So like TENS units and electrical stimulation devices sometimes are used as well. And movement therapies also can be used, including yoga and other kinds of tai chi, etc. These, even done through video, can also be actually very helpful. And so, again, it really depends on your pain. You know, can you actually use medications or other things to actually help you participate in these activities? And that that allows for you know, improvements in the pain level. From a procedural management, there is also, yes.
Before you move on to procedural, I seem to notice a complete lack of medical cannabis for pain. What's the reason for that?
So medical cannabis for pain. Yeah. Thoughts in the group?
I'll touch on that after. I'll touch on that after.
Okay. All right. And you'll get into pros, cons.
I'll get into my personal experience as a caregiver and for my wife.
Okay.
Not the technical. I don't know anything about cannabis. It's like CB2 receptors or anything like that. I'll let you hear that.
Sure. Okay. Yeah. So in general, it is out there. I think there is honestly a challenge and a disconnect right now that we have in our community. And so I think, as most people know, it still is federally illegal, but yet it's state legalized in many places. And so when it's federally illegal, that actually prevents a lot of things, including a lot of research dollars being used to be able to study it really well, having it being able to actually even be possessed on campuses. So any federally funded premise like a school, hospital, you know, library, et cetera, some other places that actually get federal funds, it's actually a federal offense to actually have cannabis on campus with you. And so, yeah, including at City of Hope, where our policy is you're not actually allowed to possess cannabis on campus. That said, we have had a number of patients who have anecdotally had a lot of benefit from it. And so it's not to say that it doesn't help, you know, so even if you think about morphine, for example, you think about heroin, right? So some of the derivatives are actually very closely aligned. So I have nothing bad to say necessarily about cannabis as in general, but I would say is that ultimately I can't guarantee that my patient going to a local dispensary will get the right amount of cannabis or the right combination of things to actually help with pain. So there's over, you know, hundreds of receptors effectively that cannabis through the cannabinoid and other receptors actually impact. And with that, it's really, you know, kind of a combination of, they say that some of them actually help with nausea. And so you do have some, like dronabinol is a medication that's now FDA approved based off of cannabis. And you can reliably get, you know, certain amounts of things for it. It's being seen, you know, to be beneficial in, again, pain, seizure, appetite, etc. But yet I can't say go to this place and get this reliable amount. And that's my biggest challenge right now with being able to recommend it. So it's, you know, take that with a grain of salt.
Yeah,
Not saying it's not effective, but you know, I just don't know where you can get a reliable, effective supply of what may help you. There may be people online to hear you.
You all have a drink, and sometimes you drive. You all have medications you take that are opioids.
There it is. And I don't want to take up everybody's time, but I'm tired of seeing this slept under the streets by the medical world at times. You have to get and start looking ahead a little bit. It saved my life between my doctor and getting proper medical cannabis for pain. I would not be here today. And I don't like to see all of the doctors going, oh yeah, this is terrible. It's a bad thing to do this. You are then creating my destiny for me by not allowing me to have it. Now I went and got it on my own because I was going downhill. I went from 230 to 170 in 38 days. And I said, you've got to eat or we're going to feeding tube you. You got to do this or we're going to stop your chemo and you then jeopardize your bone marrow. Those are not good options for me. I said, would you guys, all my doctors, would you prescribe medical marijuana, medical cannabis? Yes, but we can't tell you how much to take. We don't know because we're not allowed to. Well, what a shame. Yeah. You will take a medication. You will take a painkiller. All of those are heavy. Heavy drugs. You will drive, you will drink, you will smoke, but you poo-poo medical marijuana? I think you got to reissue this into an attitude that presents itself that is very possible. I am a living proof of it, and I'm not alone. Yeah. Between CBD oil and all of that, it's a good thing. I know you want me to shut up.
No. It's absolutely genuine. What I would say, and in my personal stance is, I think there absolutely is some benefit to it. I think we need to change it at the federal level. So you need to change policy to then allow it to be studied in the same way that everything else does. Many of the other drugs that we have that we'll get into have been, you know, they come from natural sources as well. And that I'm able to know that when I give this to a patient, it's studied. I know the side effects. I know how much to give, what doses generally might lead to which side effects, et cetera. And I hope that we get there with cannabis as well. So then I can actually reliably prescribe it. But we just have to work at the federal level and make sure that we then work its way down appropriately. So as far as we'll get to questions at the end. Ah, great. Yeah, so we need more of that. That's great. So as far as procedural management for pain, I'll just touch on this very briefly. So this is celiac plexus. Basically, if you're thinking about non-medication options, the celiac plexus is a bundle of nerves. So as I was talking about earlier, you essentially have pain that's from different sources. And so you have nerve pain and kind of just generalized somatic pain from the organ itself. But really, pain is what you feel in your head in some ways and in the brain. And so all of that travels through the nerves to get there. And so this bundle of nerves here, the celiac plexus, actually takes nerves from the stomach and through many other areas in the organs in your abdomen, and it travels up. And what sometimes people will do is they'll actually give a local injection of a numbing medication, so something like lidocaine, and they'll actually see, if we give this lidocaine injection, will this actually minimize pain? And if it does work, then, and depending on the thought for surgery or not, they actually will sometimes inject alcohol to actually more permanently try and, or phenol to more permanently try and help disable those nerves so that then you don't have all that pain going up. And when you do something like this, this actually also minimizes the amount of medications that you would need to provide somebody. So another myth sometimes is pain medications all work the same way. So, you know, we heard about cannabis a little bit, but there's definitely a lot of different medications that we have. And they work on many different aspects of the whole, from the brain to the spinal cord to the local tissue, actually. And we don't have time to go into all of these, but if you go to Medscape or if you go to Google and you look at where pain medications work, you can actually see, essentially how they actually work at all the different types of levels. And ultimately, what we try and do is we don't just say it's just a single approach. We try and actually have multiple medications that work at different levels to allow for kind of a multimodal approach to pain. This is the World Health Organization's stepladder of pain. So oftentimes they'll say you start with weaker medications, like, and this is acetaminophen, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs like ibuprofen, and then get into weak opioids, strong opioids, and then into all these adjuvants. Now, oftentimes, especially in cancer pain, they're moving this step four up here, basically between step one and two. And so you want to do a lot of these other medications like amitriptyline, gabapentin. These are actually anti-nerve medications, which are oftentimes helpful. Pregabalin is oftentimes there. Ketamine also and clonidine. They also are helpful in this case. And this is LA's local anesthetics and then procedures. And we talked about one with the celiac plexus block. I wanted to just highlight a couple of the pain medications for you as well. And so this one, acetaminophen. So the reason for this list is that there's really hundreds of types of acetaminophen out there. There's one acetaminophen, but it's in combination with so many different things that you can get over the counter. So it's there for headache pain, it's there for arthritis, it's there for sleep, and other things as well. And the challenge is that this is actually one of the most common causes of acute liver failure in the United States, toxicity to acetaminophen or Tylenol, basically. And so the moral of the story here is that it can be helpful for pain medications. It does help a lot, but you really need to be very mindful of what is all of these sources of acetaminophen that you're taking in. So when your doctor gives it to you in a pain medication, you need to make sure that if you're taking something over the counter, you really do look at that. The bottle may say, or the doctor may say, up to 4,000. We're really recommending 3,000, just because, again, sometimes we don't even know what's in the medications we're taking, just to be extra safe so we don't cause liver failure ultimately. Before I jump into opioids, which is really the mainstay of oftentimes a lot of pain medication as well too, I do want to speak to the opioid crisis, right? So we're hearing a lot about that these days. And so this is a letter actually even from 2016 from the previous Surgeon General Vivek Murthy. And he basically sent a letter to every single physician in the United States and said that we have a huge problem. We have people who are dying from opioids, and we need to do something to address this. And so he created a website called turnthetiderx.org. Additionally, we've seen a lot of things in the news recently. And so I don't know if people have seen this in the last couple of years, but this is in Hacienda Heights. And so we do have some bad practices that are occurring, but also there's other things that happen. And so this is a physician who was actually killed by a spouse of a patient. And so, physician, I think, may have told the patient, I'm so sorry, we're not allowed to use opioids as much, or we need to reduce things, et cetera. And then the spouse went after the physician and actually killed them in the Midwest. So we have a lot of things happening. And then more recently, there's many other things, so you probably have seen in the news, Some drug companies are now filing for bankruptcy. Nearly every single state has lawsuits out against opioid companies. And so we're going to see a lot of things, I think, change from that with, addiction and other things that are happening. But we need to, take all of these in light of, we still have populations of patients who really do need pain medications. This also was saying as well, too, just in terms of the opioid crisis. So this is a graph looking at deaths from heroin and also opioids. And so here you see that this is like back in the early 2000s. This was oxycodone, actually, this red curve. And basically you see here there's a spike of deaths that are increasing and related to oxycodone deaths. And it was being sold in the street. Patients or people were actually taking it and they were dying from it. And what they ended up doing was they actually had introduced a anti-abuse formulation of oxycodone at that time. And what that did was it essentially prevented people from essentially cutting a long-acting medication and getting overdosed from that. which when you cut a long-acting pill, which you should not do ever, that basically oftentimes will make an immediate release medication. So it makes them more dangerous to patients. But unfortunately, what happened there was that then, while the deaths decreased from the oxycodone, the deaths from heroin then started climbing back again. And so this is much more of a global problem than just the opioids that come from doctors and from drug companies. But I think we do need to make sure that we're looking at the whole thing collectively. So as far as opioids, so this is actually the poppy plant from which opioids and morphine ultimately comes from. It is oftentimes the mainstay of pain management and palliative medicine. And so there's oftentimes short side effects. So you can have nausea, itching, sweating, sleepiness. Those are pretty short-lived and they generally go away. But then you have things like constipation, which oftentimes stay there. That said, if you have surgery, right, and we heard about dumping syndrome earlier, this may actually help in terms of dumping syndrome because it'll actually slow down your bowels as opposed to having so much diarrhea. One of the feared side effects of opioids is also respiratory depression. If I take it, you know, I'm going to stop breathing, I'm going to, you know, go to sleep and never wake up. So when doctors prescribe it, one of the most important things is take it as your doctor prescribes it. Don't adjust your own doses. And really what this is saying is that essentially in order to actually stop somebody's breathing, you have to actually take it not only at a certain dose, but for a long enough time to actually have that happen to somebody. And so if you think about, for example, a long-acting medication, I don't take any pain medications. If I were to take one, then a long-acting medication would stay in my system for many, many hours. And so initially, you know, I appear alert right now. But then, you know, I might go to becoming confused, you know, delirious, lethargic. You might have to then, you know, shake me to or like speak to me really loudly to try and wake me up. If I keep on getting affected by the medications, you may have to actually, you know, shake me or even cause pain. At some point, you may actually not even be able to wake up somebody. And it's only after that point that you would then essentially affect the brainstem. And that would then truly cause respiratory depression. So that's where people truly have, you know, true respiratory depression that can cause death ultimately. So long-acting opioids, that's really where we're worried about this. But really also if you, you know, take things into your own hands and people adjust it is the other big thing. Other downsides, so we only have a few minutes left, so I'm going to blitz through a few different things. I will say you need to make sure that pain medication is not just episodic. It really should be both a long-acting pain medication because people generally have a lot of pain at baseline, as well as when you move or you do other things that cause pain, you want to take breakthrough amounts of pain medications as well, too. And so oftentimes people recommend a extended release medication and an immediate release medication. Here, not as much for gastric cancer, and then an anti-emetic agent for, you know, something to prevent nausea. Neuropathic pain, that is definitely there as well. So you can't just use opioids is the moral here. After a gastrectomy, I think some of the other things is that basically the main aspect here is that you have a shorter amount of gut to absorb things. And so when that happens, then sometimes people won't be able to process the pills that are given to you ultimately. And so we have to think about other means. So here, subcutaneous, they may have fentanyl patches, which can absorb through the skin. So you don't have to worry about the gut. Sometimes we'll do IV medications with your PICC line or pain pump, and also oral medications. Liquid also sometimes is absorbed differently than pills. And then pain medications should be taken sparingly. So when patients can't tolerate the pain anymore. How many people like to take pain medications right away as compared to I hate pills and I want to wait until I can't take it anymore? So usually the analogy I give is think about pain like a fire. Think about medications like a bucket of water. Which, if you had one bucket of water, which fire would you want to use it on? Left or right? Left. Yep. So essentially, right, if you throw a match and, you know, you just have a match, you dump a bucket of water on it, it goes out right away. You toss a match in the building, now half the building's on fire, you use that same bucket of water, it's not going to work very well. And so really, especially for cancer pain, you really need to take the pain medications early so that then you can essentially knock it out and be comfortable as compared to waiting, the pain builds up. Oral medications oftentimes will take about 30, 45 minutes to even work from the time that you take it. So it really is important to take it early so that then, again, you're not, you know, dealing with a lot of pain later. Another big worry that people have is I don't want to get addicted. And so, you know, there's these words that we have here, dependence, tolerance, addiction, pseudo-addiction. Anybody drink coffee, tea, caffeine in any form? So what happens if you stop drinking coffee or tea? Nothing. Some people say, I never stop. Some people get headaches. Some people get jittery, agitated, etc. So that's actually a withdrawal symptom. Are you addicted to coffee, tea, soda? Maybe. So at least what you are is dependent. And so what that means is that if you take something, you stop it, you get withdrawals, your body has that type of dependency on it. The other thing that happens is not over immediately, but over days or really weeks or months, you may need more of something to get the same effect. So how many people still only drink one cup of coffee a day or tea or others? Usually only a couple of people. Most people drink more after a period of time. Addiction is really the phenomenon where basically you have essentially you're neglecting duties that you really should be performing. So at City of Hope, we actually have a Starbucks that was put in maybe 4 or 5 years back. And so what I tell people is, you know, one, it's okay if you have withdrawals if you stop drinking coffee. Secondly, if you drink more coffee than you did when you first started, that's also okay. If you're in the line in Starbucks and you should be seeing patients in clinic, then maybe that's, there you go. That may be the telltale sign of addiction there. Yes. A patient line? It is. I know. I don't know if maybe ask Dr. Wu to help advocate. Oh, there you go. There you go. And then addiction, very briefly. So oftentimes, you know, there are some questions that one can ask as far as, you know, is somebody more at risk or less at risk? There's also a big component with the family and genetics as well. And so if there's a history of addiction in the family, then you should be more mindful of that and be much more cautious with your doctor and be upfront about those things, as well as a personal history. This is basically just saying the more opioids that you're given or the longer you're on opioids, the higher likelihood that you're going to stay on opioids. So if we can use less pain medications and if you can take less medications overall to stay comfortable and still do what you need to do comfortably, that's going to be better for you in order to get off of the opioids. Because while we want to start it and use it in order to make sure you're comfortable, we also don't want to just keep you on it, you know, permanently. And then this is really just saying that it really takes a partnership. So between the doctors, the care team, the patients and the families, we really all need to ultimately work together to make sure that we're taking care of your pain. This is basically saying it's not just your one doctor and you as a patient and your family, but really that there's many. There's physical therapy, occupational therapy, social work, psychology, physical medicine, rehabilitation, you know, the acupuncturist, et cetera, that we talked about. So many, many people that can help you through pain. And then just to wrap up here, a couple things in terms of just safety for community. So one is that we really should be, if you have opioids and or any type of controlled substance, cannabis or otherwise, they really should be locked up. So you should ideally, you know, have a lockbox. Actually, if you come to City of Hope, we have lockboxes that we provide at cost, you know, to patients if you wanted to get that, or you can get them on Amazon or anywhere else. And basically what they did in a study was they looked at cancer patients and they saw that almost 20% of people kept opioids in plain sight. They also saw that 70% stored the opioids hidden but unlocked. And really few people actually kept them locked up. And that becomes a problem because then if you have kids or others who come over, they may actually get into them and that may become a gateway drug into other kinds of things. Even just handouts on opioid storage and safety has been found to be helpful. So thank you very much, and open for maybe a couple minutes of questions. I think I ate into that a little bit.
Yep. What are your suggested alternatives?
Yep. So basically, there's many options, to be honest. And so one would be ibuprofen. If your doctor says that your kidneys are okay, the Tylenol in higher doses can affect that. But otherwise, you also have, you know, opioids that can be given. But this is really, as you can see here, you know, there's many, many options that people have, and it really is your doctor working with you ultimately to say, what is everything else that's going on? And then how do we actually appropriately, you know, treat it? Yes.
Stomach. What would you recommend as far as taking something for moderate pain tolerance? You know, I was told to stay away from Tylenol, for example. Anything you would recommend?
Yeah. So again, I would say honestly, talk to your doctor because it really is like, what are your labs? What are other things that are going on? Ibuprofen is there over the counter, you know, so that's like Advil or other things. But ultimately, it could be that you know, opioids or other things are necessary for you. And then if your pain can be alleviated through some of those non-medication options, yeah, that also should be talked about. Again, I think with your doctor ultimately. So, yeah. Other questions? Yeah, sorry, I wish I can give specific recommendations, but it really is very, you know, personal and individualized. So. Okay, thank you so much.